Friday was the bloodiest day in a month of protests in Syria
for crimes against humanity.
A decade of war that has left hundreds of thousands dead.
For more than 10 years now, the headlines coming out of Syria have depicted dictatorship.
Yeah, this is the war Bashar Assad is waging on his own people.
Death.
Nearly 12,000 children have been killed or injured.
And destruction.
Entire neighborhoods lie destroyed, leaving an apocalyptic scene.
But in one corner of the internet, you can see a very different side to Syria.
I love Syria, and you will not believe how amazing it is.
Good evening, guys. Right now, I'm in Damascus.
Thanks to some unlikely visitors.
I first heard about travel bloggers to Syria post-war in 2019.
Good morning, guys, and welcome to Damascus, Syria. I didn't know what to expect from Damascus, really, but this wasn't really it. Like, it feels like any other nice touristy city.
It was amazing to see Damascus again. That's where my mom lived for quite some time. And as a Syrian, I got very emotional seeing that footage and seeing Bakhdash.
This looks absolutely amazing.
Seeing her eating the ice cream and they give it to her for free. But mostly I remember being kind of shocked that they were doing that already.
This is the Syrian stamp.
The travel bloggers were already heading to Syria as a travel destination.
We are in Japan, guys.
Another beautiful sunny day here in Barbados.
Travel vlogging is a huge online industry. And to stand out, many vloggers have been visiting so-called alternative travel destinations. The kind more often seen in the headlines than the travel brochures.
We're in Tripoli, Libya. Unbelievable.
It's a winning formula, and it's generated millions of views and dollars for both the content creators and the social media companies.
I was just so hyped on all the positive things about Syria. The people, the food, the love.
But in a place like Syria, is this content cutting corners with the truth just to please the algorithms?
You know, when there's a war, it's not raining bombs on every single inch of Syria. People are still living there. My family is still there. They still, you know, go to work every day. But this very simplistic view of life in Syria lacks nuance of how life actually is inside a war. These streets that I saw in the videos are real, but they're very touristy. Syria is very big, and it's not one neighborhood or one very Instagrammable street.
We just stopped for a photo of that. Look at that.
I think that they pretty accurately reflect the life of wealthy Syrians in Damascus. And that's kind of the power of inviting travel bloggers into that city specifically, because it was less hard hit. Because there are a lot of pro-regime Syrians, especially wealthy ones, which are very much in the minority. Many of them are located in Damascus. So in terms of inviting tourism into Syria, Damascus is a very safe bet.
We asked the Syrian Tourism Ministry whether foreign travel influencers were being invited into the country for PR purposes. They didn't respond. What we do know is that every tourist visiting Syria, travel vloggers included, is legally required to be accompanied at all times by a government-approved guide, what journalists would call a handler. So, while vloggers are exploring the markets of Damascus,
oh my God, so good,
roaming the ruins of Aleppo, or chatting to locals in Tartus.
You, Ahmed?
Mohammed.
The eyes and ears of the government are never far away. Dawood Akhundzada knows this firsthand. He's a travel vlogger who just returned from Syria a few weeks ago.
Of course, I had to get a guide. You cannot just wander around yourself as a tourist with a touristic visa in Syria.
I'm here with my guide, Mary.
Hi.
So what the guides do, after you leave the country, they're reporting it to the government. Where have you been and what you have done in the country?
This is the real nightlife of Syria as of now. Check this out.
I was there during the Christmas time. People were having fun in the cafes, having shisha. So this is one of the videos I shared as well. But I also shared other part of it, the leftovers from the civil war.
Do you want to see what civil war brings to the country? Right now I'm in Syria, in the biggest city called Homs. And all around me is just destroyed buildings.
I think people, specifically Syrians, had very mixed feelings about my content. They were thinking that I am sold out and it's a propaganda for the government, and I'm actually paid to be in Syria and make this content, which is absolutely not true.
Syria is not only about civil war and depressing headlines.
Hey Davood, fun fact, on Christmas Day, the same day you posted that regime-sponsored propaganda, six opposition fighters were murdered in northern Syria.
One of the reasons why I made that TikTok about Davood is he specifically made a video of some destroyed buildings, and his messaging was, see what war gets you, it gets you nothing.
As a result, this is what we have left.
Which to me was very heart-wrenching. There are results of the war with the regime. Every travel vlogger I'm aware of says, well, I'm not political. But how can you show the destruction of a political war and still be apolitical?
When you go into a war zone and say it's apolitical, it's only documentation, and you're showing only one side, then if you're documenting, you should actually do more research and more work and go to places where, you know, you don't have a fixer from the side of the regime showing you around. This is a very political space you're standing in that is under regime control, and the regime is showing you what they want the world to know.
Part of the problem is that journalists are not being allowed in, except for media from countries the regime considers friendly, like Russia and Iran, states that have backed President Bashar al-Assad. Few foreign reporters have been able to visit government-held Syria in recent years. That's left the vloggers and other more controversial figures to fill the information gap, blurring the lines between content creator and journalist.
There was an army created inside Syria, which they called themselves Free Army, and they were fighting against Syrian government.
I'm not a journalist, I'm just a simple content creator. And I feel like people right now trust individuals and the content creators more than the news. What I wanted to do is just show a little bit different side and more authentic side of Syria. Syria will become another very important destination for the region and for the touristic destination as well. And I do feel like the content I share helps it a little bit.
Despite the ongoing fighting, the millions of Syrians displaced, and the fact that around a third of the country remains beyond his control, Assad is ready to reintroduce himself to the world. States that had once denounced his rule are now resuming diplomatic ties, and along with it, lucrative energy and trade deals. For the global news audience, however, it's a much harder sell, and that's why the regime needs all the help it can get.
When you have 10 years of conflict, afterwards comes, you know, the writing history part, the normalization with the world part. These vloggers are a very small part of this plan. I personally don't think that tourism right now in Syria is ethical. It is only aiding the bigger message that the regime wants to come across, which is that Syria is safe. Syria is not safe, especially not for Syrians who want to return.
Every Syrian wants the world to hear and to see Syria as they know it, as this beautiful, historical, magical place. And in that sense, who can blame the travel vloggers for wanting to tell that story? But this tourism without journalism is mostly harmful. I want the story of Syria to be told. But I want the whole story told.